Hey everybody, Dr. Schultz with the Centennial Schultz Clinic with another weekly update. Today we're going to be talking about what in the world is a thoracic compression fracture. So thanks for checking in and let's get started. The goals of this short presentation are to review the anatomy, to explain what in the world is a thoracic compression fracture, the major causes, the symptoms, how to diagnose a compression fracture, what are the treatment options, and most importantly, what are the consequences if left untreated? So the anatomy, what in the world is a vertebral body? So basically it's the bony building blocks that stack one on top of the other that make the spine. As you know, this illustration here is there's three parts of the spine. There's the cervical, then the mid-back, otherwise known as the thoracic, and then the lumbar. And there's essentially these bony building blocks that stack one on top of each other. And here it's depicted from a cross-section, otherwise known as an axial. And there's a couple important parts about the vertebral body that are worth mentioning. Here's the vertebral body itself. It's the front of the vertebral body, and then there's an arch, and then there's the backside, otherwise known as posterior. This is where you can feel on a loved one's or a child's back this kind of dinosaur bone. It's called the spinous process. Now with that anatomy, now you can understand that most thoracic compression fractures occur in the body. That's right, the front portion of this vertebral body. It's basically a fracture or a crack. It typically occurs in the lower thoracic region. And here's an illustration of an x-ray. You can see the vertebral body here and the one below. And here is actually a fracture where the vertebral body is fractured. Ouch. So a thoracic compression fracture is quite common. There's approximately 1 to 1.5 million per year. And unfortunately, 25% of all postmenopausal women will have some sort of fracture in the thoracic spine at some point. Now, what are the causes? The number one cause of a thoracic compression fracture is osteoporosis. That's basically a weakening of the bones. Now, there are other causes, and those include trauma, aging. You know, as we get older, we're less flexible, and there's decreased bone density. In addition, cancer can also cause a fracture. And then osteopenia. I know it's a fancy word. It's basically a reduction in the bone mineral density. It's a precursor, if you will, of osteoporosis. Now, the symptoms of a thoracic compression fracture vary, but the most common is pain. That's right, pain, as depicted here. You also can have significant reduction in flexibility. You can have a hunched posture, otherwise known as kyphosis. Oftentimes, patients have a reduction in their height, can't figure out why. Nerve irritation can be included. And in severe cases, you can have a bowel or bladder dysfunction secondary to spinal cord or nerve irritation or injury. Now, how to diagnose it? It starts with a detailed medical history and examination. And more often than not, there are radiographic studies, which I've illustrated here, which include an MRI and a CAT scan. But most importantly, a DEXA scan is the gold standard, and it basically measures bone mineral density. Treatment options for conservative care include rest, bracing, pain management, oral medications, topical medications. And when those aren't sufficient, there are some interventional or advanced treatment options. And there's two big words. There's a vertebroplasty and a kyphoplasty. And in essence, it's a needle through which bone cement, that's right, bone cement is injected into the area of fracture. The goal is to stabilize an inherently unstable spine. And they do so by injecting this bone cement. Now, beyond a compression fracture, we have to think globally. And that's what we do at the Centennial Schultz Clinic. So we look at the spine as a functional spine unit. That means there are lots of moving pieces that work together in a very synchronized fashion. And when you look globally at all these different pieces, you have a much better understanding of the spine and possible sources of pain. So with a compression fracture, you have significant structural changes. You also have changes in the biomechanics, and there are lots of different areas. This illustration here is a depiction of when we look at the spine, you can look at it from three different columns. There's the anterior, the middle, and then the posterior. Any and all of these can be a source of pain, dysfunction, and changes in biomechanics. So when looking at a thoracic compression fracture, you also need to look at whether or not the thoracic facet, the disc, the ligament, and the tendons are involved. If left untreated, a thoracic compression fracture can be a significant source of disability. It can certainly be a source of chronic pain, reduced mobility, postural changes as depicted here. We see these patients sometimes in the store, sometimes in the park. They're hunched forward, otherwise known as kyphosis. There also can be neurologic symptoms depending upon the severity of the compression fracture and whether or not there's irritation of the spinal cord or exiting nerves. And most importantly, the quality of life can be compromised if a thoracic compression fracture is not addressed. At the Centennial Schultz Clinic, we are experts in the evaluation and treatment of thoracic injuries. If you or a loved one have been put on the sideline as a result of a compression fracture or any thoracic condition, consider giving us a call. We are committed to understanding the source of the dysfunction. What's the actual cause as opposed to simply treating the symptoms? We have in-office evaluations, and for those outside of the Denver-Boulder area, we also have virtual evaluations. Thank you so much for checking in today. I hope this was helpful and that you got a better understanding of thoracic compression fractures. Till next time, thanks so much.